drafted into teams of four, two men, two women. It's a revolutionary format, and we conclude the 2023 season here. Tyson McGuffin, what a story he is. Has such a positive attitude. He's done so much for the sport. Had some injury adversity early on this season. People were kind of wondering where he would stack, and even into last year, and here he is, peak game.
I'll admit it. There's a couple times in his career I thought he was going to dip. I thought his level was going to drop and possibly get passed by. Has not happened. I am very happy to eat my words and my thoughts right there. Tyson McGuffin, as I said at the top of the broadcast, legend of the game and just an absolute warrior out on the pickleball court.
By the way, told me he's building a four-court facility in his backyard in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. Not bad digs. Mm-hmm. Total yeah. Man cave. He'll do his podcasts out of there. I'm sure there'll be a cold tub and a wellness center too. That guy's got it. He's got it figured out.
He really does. I am well behind Tyson building my own compound in North Carolina, a four-court facility in Coeur d'Alene. I hope I get to make it out there one of these days. That'd be awesome.
Just invite yourself.
Yeah.
A trip.
I already did.
Great. I'll come with you and invite myself on your trip. His birthday's coming up too, by the way, December 16th. Happy early birthday to Tyson McGuffin, turning 34 in December. And I'm going to run for Ben Johns this weekend. This guy has been playing pickleball since last Thursday in men's singles. Ben Johns triple crown this weekend at the PPA Final. He won in mixed, he won in men's doubles, and he now has 109 career PPA titles to his name.
Opponents are. He is doing this to world-class pickleball athletes, consistently winning at such a high clip. That's what makes it most impressive to me, is the quality of his opponents and just too good. It's too good.
Well, we will step aside for just a moment, get you back out to the action as the greatest to ever do it, Ben Johns, looks to carry his team to the next round. We'll be right back. First serve between the Chicago Slice and the Miami Pickleball Club. You are watching Major League Pickleball as we conclude season two here in 2023. And only a couple of teams made it into the mix. Miami and Chicago, two of those, as well as the DC Pickleball team in Orlando. Orlando won the match this morning, so they advanced to tomorrow, Tuesday's championship round, season championship, that is. And whoever wins this one will advance to square off against the DC Pickleball team. The match to follow this one, which, how do you feel about playing back-to-back? That's an interesting topic of conversation. Whoever wins this one, here's the head-to-head numbers. With the men's doubles matchup, a perfect 50-50 split, which makes sense because it's been close all the way down the stretch. If you remember Atlanta, Tyson and Fed were right in it, close, and then Eric Lang and Ben Johns pulled away at the last moment.
Yeah, 13.6 and 13.61, my goodness. If this isn't a good one, I will be absolutely shocked. And yeah, fellas coming out first. Let's
go. Miami
actually chose to put out the men's team first. They won the toss. They chose to react, the first choice. Then the Slice chose to receive That would be Ben Johns weighing in there. And then Miami chose to put their men's doubles team out first. Interesting, because they haven't had the edge in this matchup.
Fancy footwork from Fed after the Ernie attempt went awry, but a couple dinks later, putting one into the net. 1-0 slice.
Football, left foot. Point.
Yikes. Not a great start for Federico Staxfruit. Of course, this is rally scoring. Games to 21, win by two, and on your serve.
2-0.
You have that left toe just sneaking in. Staxfruit made it to the PPA finals as well. Down the middle finish from Eric Lang.
That was very deceptive from Eric Lang. I'm not sure if he was reading Federico Staxfruit going for the Ernie, but either way, splitting the defense right up the middle. Nice shot, Eric.
Point.
Two now, back-to-back slippery attacks from Eric Lang, full on deception as Staxfruit not even bringing his paddle up as that ball sails past his left shoulder.
4-0.
And a 5-0 start for the Chicago Slice. What's going on with Miami right now?
Yeah, just 5-0. A couple loose errors. Besides for those two attacks from the Slice, it's been errors on the near end.
ATP delivered by Ben Johns.
That's right, and he's got both varieties. He can come around the ball with a bit of side spin and top spin and also go with the slice. Nice to have both options on the ATPs.
You think that guy's exhausted? He's triple crowning every single weekend and off of a 4-straight-day performance on the PPA finals, now playing in the team format. Unbelievable. It's been a long season for a lot of these players.
Absolutely. Burnout is real. Not saying that that's the case here, but a long year, and off-court work so important for all these athletes, but it sure as heck even more important when you make it to the dang finals in every event. So I think that that's been a great job for a lot of these athletes, and especially the athletes making deep runs consistently. You must be in good shape. You can't let that fatigue creep into your legs in these big moments.
Much pressure for Eric Lang in this partnership when you know you are going to be the target every single time?
Easy and hard playing with Ben Johns when he kind of takes 80% of the court, hits 4 or 5 shots and wins the point. You know, that's great. You don't have to do a whole lot, but you have to give him the runway and the court to allow him to do his thing, and that sometimes puts you out of positions. And let's be clear, if you lose with Ben as your partner, it's your fault. So that's mental pressure and physical pressure that you feel partnering with him on the right side.
Totally fair.
Point.
Oh, my.
Yeah, and you can see Fed really showing some visible 7-0. Frustration after that last error.
Lob there from Eric Lang. Dave Fleming says the future is lob in 2024 in pickleball. Do you agree?
Hey, I did that 2 or 3 years ago. Mixed results, granted. Mixed results with my lobbing, but I love it. Get those big, aggressive fellas off of the kitchen line. Push them back. And when you do it with deception and at the right time, it can be a great offensive weapon.
My goodness, Ben Johns, he can't keep the ball away from him.
Yeah, that's a night-night. Goes up high to the forehand. I mean, it's coming back less than 10% of the time. Put away power on point.
Point.
Some good defense from Fed gets burned that time. A 10-1 start for Chicago. Will change ends at 11.
10-1. Side out. Point.
So if you're Miami, anything can shift in a moment with Rally scoring. What are you trying to focus on?
Well, what you talked about before the match. Maybe Eric, very consistent with his dinks and found some offense a couple different ways. Maybe you push the ball over to Ben and try to find a way to attack Eric.
Point.
And there you go, right there. That's one attack. Now you have to be careful because he is very powerful with that one-handed backhand counter from his chest. So as long as you aren't going to that specific spot, you can have some success.
Side out, point, 11.
Another error means Chicago gets to 11 first, and we will change ends at 11-3 and take a break with that as well. Get you back out to the rest of game one after this.
Coverage of Major League Pickleball is brought to you in part by Hospital for Special Surgery, the official hospital of Major League Pickleball, and by Toyota Prius. It's ace now.
An ocean view here from center court. Can't beat this luxurious pickleball facility here at the Lifetime Athletic Country Club of San Clemente. Many players say this
time
is their
in.
Favorite
11,
stop
three.
On tour.
Side
good
out.
Pressure there
point
from Federico Staxroot.
Yeah, definitely needed that one as this is a lopsided affair early.
4-11.
Might look for Miami to be a little more aggressive and offensive minded moving forward. Just playing his role to perfection right now. Some mixed in offense at the right moments and just
12,
an absolute
four.
Rock of consistency early, halfway through this match at this point.
Side out, point five.
There you go. You can see Johnny Goldberg, the team coach, and Mary Brasha on the sideline getting them fired up after that last point. They are going to need the energy.
pass, and McGuffin finds it with a perfect amount of pace and spin.
Yes, you do not see that kind of Ben being fooled, basically.
6-12.
He was looking for that ball up the line. That is great deception from Tyson McGuffin. Clean winner.
Side out.
Nice play from Eric Lang, pulling 13. McGuffin out wide.
Yeah, I like that. I think a high percentage of the time he's going to attack 13, Federico, who is back. He decides to go to that outside foot of Tyson. Good decision from Eric.
Point.
Eric Lang not only took a drive that Ben wanted, hung in the point, too.
Yeah, great backhand counter from Eric.
14,
that
six.
Reach allows him to sit heavy backhand and cover most of his half.
Side out.
That's a heat check right there. It's all been working. I think he was four for four, so we'll label
seven,
that one a
14.
Little ambitious, but you can't blame him with the early offensive success that he's had.
Side out.
Guffin pulled
point.
The trigger.
15.
Missed it. So if you're Miami, not beating Ben or Eric Lang, why would you
15,
put your next doubles
seven.
Team out first? I wonder what the strategy was there.
Yeah, maybe it's that kind of that adage, catch them early. Catch them early, maybe they can be flat, I don't know. I mean, they haven't played a match either way, whether they start or they play
15.
Second after the women. So not exactly sure on that. Maybe we can get some intel on why that was the choice.
Tyson McGuffin on the run and on the poach.
That's right, and it's not the easiest to come across from the right side and poach
nine,
with the backhand. But Tyson McGuffin, well done there. Did that drop in? My goodness. Wow. What great spin and control from Ben Johns. I thought there was no
16,
way that ball
nine.
Was going to drop, but it did.
It in down the line, too good.
Just stop it, Ben. I mean, two in a row, almost no pace, and just drops them just inside the line. I do not blame Tyson at all for loading up forehand right where he did. You said it, Michelle, and I'm gonna say it again, too good.
And he showed that cross-court backhand dink beat identically, and then pushes it down the line. What can you even do but a side out and point for Miami.
Nice job by Federico with the counterattack, able to get that ball down. And we know that Eric Lang has a ton of power
11,
in his paddle. And when you get it down to him, he will often sail that next shot
point
long. And that's exactly
18.
What we saw there. Yeah, when it rains, it pours for Miami. Service error.
18, 11.
Good opportunity to go for a run. Anything in rally scoring is possible. The angle from Federico Staxrud making up
20,
for that missed serve.
12.
Yeah, nice put away from Fed. Eric Lang squeezing the middle a bit too much, and Fed
12,
finding
18.
The angle out wide. There's again Federico counterattacking from the midcourt, but getting the ball down and definitely kind of the biggest roar from the players on court on the Miami
13,
side and
18.
The fans. Let's see if they can springboard forward for a few more.
Side out.
You got to get out of there, Eric. You got to get out of there. I know it's tough when you get those big tree trunk legs locked in there, 19, but you got to get out of there.
Point.
Yeah, this is surprising from Fed. Has got himself 20, so consistent 13. On the doubles court. Just not playing his best game right now.
Game point, just like that for Chicago. CTP from Tyson McGuffin. Chicago almost stayed alive, couldn't do it.
Yeah, not an awesome job by Tyson because he was almost had that left foot on the 14, center sideline as most balls being forced to Federico. So great athleticism to get out wide for the ATP.
Federico Staxrud staying alive. Remember, you have to win on your serve, so Chicago has to earn this serve back 15, before they can 20. Close it. Yeah, 2015.
There from Miami, creeping back into it a little bit.
When you start to feel in trouble if you're Chicago.
Oh, you always feel it, Michelle. 16, the MLP creep. Man, those teams down big, they get right back into it quickly.
Causes a lot of variance, and there's McGuffin stepping to the plate at 17-20.
Right, and you know, I don't love it from Lang, but I don't hate it. He had not tried that yet this match, 20. But Tyson McGuffin all over that backhand counter.
And another from Staxrud down the line, beats Eric Lang, makes it a two-point game. What was once 18-12, Adam Stone.
Yeah, great sneak in from Federico, actually able to find the right side of Eric Lang's body, which is not easy to do as he sits so heavy backhand. I like this timeout. And Miami Pickleball Club serving at 18-20. I mean, these racket paddle sports, Michelle, you don't play your best that often. So it's nice to see them stay locked in mentally after that slow start and work their way back into this match to really have a shot here.
So if you're Eric Lang right now, you played such a solid start to this game almost perfectly in that support role and then also finding that offense exactly as you said, what needs to adjust on his side of the court?
I would go a little more towards playing the rock role. He had a nice hybrid role on the right of playing solid and finding some offense, but his opponents are a little more in tune to his offensive attacks these last 5 minutes or so. So bring it back down a little bit, stay focused. Focused on the dinking and the consistency and only really go for that offense if it's really there for you.
Time in, 18-20.
Oh, Ben Johns survives the point, gets the serve back. Chicago, it feels like they have to close it here.
Eric did not listen to me there, but hey, hey, you're gonna pull a trigger. Nice to have a little backup over there on the left side.
Oh, a nice finish for Federico Staxrud, and the points continue to mount for Miami.
Yeah, I think if he hits that ball to any other part of the court, the slice get a paddle 20. On it. Perfect decision to go up the middle there.
Foot fault.
Oh no, foot fault called. Federico Staxrud crossing the plane, didn't hit the Ernie.
Yeah, he's gotten really good at those forehand Ernies from the left side. Hasn't been able to come up 20, with 19. One in this match.
Game point for Chicago, number three.
Yeah.
Austin McGuffin pulls the trigger on Eric Lang, who remained patient that entire point.
Yeah, I think for all four players, the most patient point of the match. And then the Tyson McGuffin, haven't had a chance to say this yet, the Ferrari forehand out in full force, going right at the belly button of Eric Lang cross court. Great shot from Tyson. Was definitely ambitious, probably the first one that was fully ambitious of the match. And wow, what a change in momentum. Unbelievable from the start. I believe it was 07, and here we are.
Game point for Miami now. Oh my, a missed return from Ben Johns swings this game in the direction of Miami, and that is a crucial win because Ben Johns was on the court and he is almost guaranteed to win you at least two games.
Just great mental toughness from the Miami Pickleball Club after such a slow start. Just veteran play from Tyson and a great job of playing cleaner by Federico throughout that match.
Are we challenging?
Yeah, I believe that we do have a challenge. And it looks, I can't say clearly out, but it looks certainly out. Is that a better word? I don't know.
I believe the referee just asked Miami if they were sticking with their out call, and why wouldn't you challenge it, right, if you're Chicago
sure.
at this point?
Yeah, sure. And I mean,
what do you think?
I mean, in real time, it looked quite long, and it does not look quite long on the replay, but I'm still going to say that ball is out.
And as we've discussed so many times here before with these close line calls, if you draw a line through the ball and put a nickel?
I believe it's a nickel, yes.
Underneath it. That is what would deem this. And so I think the center of that ball is actually out of bounds, like you said. We will see. Good thing that we don't have to make this decision is all I have to say. Be curious if you showed this to Ben, if you would say, if he'd acknowledge that that or not.
He would say it was out.
Okay.
After video review, the out call stands. The ball was out. Result of the rally,
okay.
22-20. Game. Miami.
Out call stands. Only a matter of millimeters for this one. And a tough break for the Chicago Slice early. Miami on top. Well, well, well. Just when you thought Ben Johns and the Chicago Slice were going to go up 1-0. Oh, no. Miami comes back from 18-12. Storms back to take game one. That's a huge advantage against this team that does not want to go into a dream breaker. Hannah Johns is with Tyson McGuffin and Federico Stackstrew to help us understand why they put the men's out first.
Guys, 0-0 and 13-20. And somehow you guys are the ones here in the winner's circle with me. What was going on out there?
No, I just started really bad. I started playing horrible. And then, Tyson just picked me up. He always, he's going to fight till the end. And that's what he did. And, we won, because of him, basically, yeah.
Well, very rare to see the men put out first. Talk me through the strategy behind that.
Yeah, I think we thought we could set the tone early. Even though we haven't beat these guys all year, we're 0-2. Just got our first win, so definitely happy about that. But it's not about how it starts, it's about how you finish. Huh? Where's my Miami fans at? Uh-huh. Girls are coming up. We're excited. Prince and the King are doing their thing.
All right, guys. 1-0. Let's see what happens. Michelle.
Always love a good word from Tyson McGuffin. Setting the tone.
That's right. I knew we were going to get a, how we doing?
He
likes the how we doing. Miami fan, San Clemente, wherever he's at. Always a good interview. And really nice to see Federico giving some props to his partner after that slow start and giving him the credit in that match, even though Fed played just fine towards the end of that one.
Tyson McGuffin is such an irreplaceable personality in the sport and what he's done from start to finish, in my opinion. But let's go over to the ladies now. Lacey Schneeman and Jesse Irvin looking to tie it up for the Chicago Slice. That is Hurricane Tyra Black, former tennis pro turned pickleball pro, says she loves the game. This game of pickleball we all love has taken her life in such a different direction, in such a positive direction. And 22 years old, a lot of upside for the Delray Beach, Florida native.
Oh, yes. Athleticism off the charts. Easy put-away power was there right from the beginning. She has gotten better and better at her shot selection and some of her soft stuff early in her career, and I expect that to continue to improve. So a great skill set to begin with and just kind of slowly becoming an all-around, well-rounded player. And Mary Brasha, as we see her partner, just an absolute consistent rock out there, playing a lot of gender doubles with her sister, but she is at this point basically a veteran of the game, and she has had a variety of results, gender mixed and singles.
Yeah, her family's from the area, just down the road from here, from Mission Viejo. Vinny Brasha and her sister Maggie, as you mentioned. There's also another sister in the mix that's a Division I athlete. Decently athletic family, I'd say. Jesse Irvin hopes she's up for the task. Another local California native, and she's 34 years old. Not a far drive for her to get to San Clemente, and she's been around for so many years, has a strong tennis background also. What is the key for Jesse Irvin to have success in this women's doubles matchup if that side switch is indeed to happen?
Yeah, so I'm looking for her to start off on the left, and so I would like to know where the offense is going to come from that team. So the Lacey Schneeman forehand out wide when she's playing the right can be very difficult to handle, and she can create from there. And Jesse Irvin has all the put-away power and the counterattacks, but can she create offense from that left? We will find out.
Lacey Schneeman, a former aerospace engineer turned pickleball pro, played college tennis at USC at the club level, and she loves rising to the occasion when it comes to pressure. Our first returner in this one.
Nice little up-the-line dink battle between Schneeman and Black early. And Tyra Black, she is known for lobbing from the back of the court, but not a lot from the kitchen line. A nice little mix into her game there.
Side out, point.
There you go. I was wondering where that offense was going to come from the left, from Jesse, and she just rips a two-hander right up the middle. Yeah, third time was not a charm from Hurricane Tyra Black. First two one-handed backhand rolls, very quality. Third one sailing long. one of the better females on tour at that specific shot.
2-1. Side out. Point.
Jesse going big with the two-hander again, this time a little deeper into the court, which makes it a more difficult shot.
Two.
Snap of the wrist from Lacey Schneeman, who made it all the way to the finals in women's singles in Daytona Beach not too long ago.
Yeah, real explosive skill set from her, and I mentioned that forehand. We saw it right there. Nothing Mary can do. And a poach from the right side. Again, saw it previously from Tyson McGuffin in the earlier match. This time, Schneeman. Yeah, she knew it. She's a legend. She's a veteran. She knows as soon as that ball touching her paddle where it's going to go. That's interesting early as we see Miami, especially Hurricane Tyra, not really looking to get into that cross-court grind with Jesse Irvin and often dinking up the line to Schneeman. We'll have to see if that pattern continues as, of course, Jesse Irvin an absolute stud at cross-court dinks.
Point. Nice drop there. That's the one she wanted just a moment ago.
Yeah, I'm not sure if Tyra was thinking of maybe letting that ball bounce. She decides at the last moment to take it out of the air.
Nice play from Mary Brasha. She made it to the PPA finals in women's singles. Mary and she and Maggie obviously play a lot of women's doubles together. Strung together a nice season and a nice finish to it. Working really hard out here in Southern California.
Yeah, just one of the many brother-sister combinations we have. Always
brother-sister.
I mean, it's a family affair, pickleball. Like, I got to bring it up once
sister,
for brother.
Sister-sister.
Sister-sister, brother-brother, whatever we're doing. Here we go. Let's go. Family affair.
Point.
Yeah, nice job by Schneeman finding the left foot of Hurricane Tyra.
Similar starts for Staxrud and Hurricane Tyra Black. Just a bit inconsistent.
Set out.
Yeah, just an interesting vibe. I think the men's match as well. It's not like there was a lot of points where we're just making errors on returns and serves, but there wasn't a ton of extended rallies until the end. And a couple short rallies early in the women's match as well. Nice call from Jesse. Weathering a couple drives from Hurricane Tyra and then calling Schneeman off that last one.
Oh!
Wow.
That was a good angle if it wasn't a foot fault for Hurricane Tyra Black.
Unreal shot. And it's crazy to see how athletic she is that she had a foot fault when she's contacting the ball almost back at the baseline.
Jesse Irvin on the attack.
Great get from Schneeman, and then her partner has her back with the put-away power. Very surprising start as everything is going through the left side player, Hurricane Tyra Black. Mary Brasha has not hit a lot of balls so far.
That is interesting. We'll have to dive into that strategy after this short break on the End Change.
Time in.
LPCNG playoffs roll on from the Lifetime Athletic Country Club of San Clemente.
Right now, Hurricane Tyra Black is going to have to figure out a way to have the Chicago Slice not target her.
Yeah, Jesse
Irvin is a very strategic player, and if it's working, she will not go away from it, I promise you. And it's odd to me because they started this way. It's not like Hurricane Tyra was playing bad and they started to go to her. They were going at her from the beginning with their patterns from the kitchen line, and my goodness, quite a bit of success.
Why do you think it's working? Like, why was that the strategy they identified from the beginning?
I think probably they're trusting Lacey Schneeman's hands in front of Hurricane Tyra and knowing that she cannot out-dink Jesse cross-court puts Tyra on the squeeze.
Should Miami consider a side change to maybe mix up the pattern?
I would say no.
15-6.
Just because Mary Brasha very comfortable on the right side in mixed and gender. But yeah, I mean it's 15-6 or 15-7 now, so even if it's something that is counterintuitive and not something you would think, you gotta pull a trigger. You can't just keep beating your head against the wall and hope for a different result. Creating offense,
16.
Wasn't positive. Putting the ball away, shoulder high. Jesse Irvin, plenty of pop.
16-7. Point.
Yeah, I'm at a bit of a loss for words. I've been calling a lot of Hurricane Tyra's matches over the last 6 to 8 months, and I have not seen this specific situation, and not 100% sure if this is physical or mental, but she has got to find a way to get more locked in. The loose airs are coming in bunches right now.
We'll lock it in for the rest of game two on the other side of this commercial break.
Time in, 17-7.
Little kitchen sink view for this point. Chicago on top, big in game two. Mary Brasha steps in and buries the backhand on Jesse Irvin.
Yeah, we finally got to say her name, Mary Brasha. Way to get in there with a big two-hander.
It's hard to involve 17. Yourself, though, when your partner's the one being targeted. Especially on that right side. Every ball back to Tyra Black. Middle was exposed.
Yeah, and this could be, coming from Ben. This could be coming from Jesse. They just love to get locked in with their pre-match strategies, and they have a very good one dialed up right now. There's a great spot from Tyra, forcing Jesse to kind of spread out of her zone. When that ball goes right to her, man, she is tough, almost never misses. But if you can get her on the move, you got a shot. Man, just really nice stuff from Lacey Schneeman on that one-handed backhand roll. I talked about Tyra's earlier, and Lacey Schneeman must have heard me because she's had some great one-handers this last few minutes.
Side out, point 10.
Well, we've seen Miami come back from a similar scoreline before in game one in men's doubles.
Side out.
Drive drop combo 20. For Hurricane Tyra, unsuccessful.
Game point for Chicago.
20-10. Side out. Point 11.
Lacey Schneeman a bit on her back foot on that third shot drive attempt. Ball back over to Miami 11, with 20. A lot of work to do.
Side out.
Lacey Schneeman. Packs a lot of power behind that slight frame.
Yeah, she's explosive 20, with her movement and her shot selection. Yeah, I think it's cool to see the difference between the two. Lacey Schneeman hits one drop and kamikazes forward. Jesse Irvin might hit 15 balls from the back of the court as she slowly works her way in. Two different strategies, both work.
Hurricane Tyra Black rises to the occasion.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that clipped the tape or not, but either way, a nice offensive shot from Tyra.
That is hard 13, mentally 20. To be the player that is receiving every ball when you know it's coming your way.
Yeah, I've been on both ends of it, mostly being the one targeted in my career, but I've been on both ends, and it is tough. It really is tough right here for Mary Brasha. You know, as it's probably 6-7-1 right now 14, in the distribution of who's hitting the shots. I personally would actually rather be targeted.
Really?
I feel like I get locked in. Because, I don't know, it just doesn't faze me that much mentally. It allows me to get locked in physically with my contact 20, points. 14. And when I've been getting frozen out before, I find...
You lose your rhythm?
That's right. You lose your rhythm. You get yourself into some awkward shots. And my goodness, just a great performance for Miami Pickleball Club as this was... I mean, sorry, for the Chicago Slice, as this was not something that I saw coming at 21-14, Michelle.
No. And a 21-14 response for Chicago. The ladies knew they needed to even out the series at one game apiece, and so they did. So we move on to the mixed doubles round, and we are at least going to four games here. Adam will be right back to discuss why the strategy worked for Schneeman and Irvin. what a gorgeous view here from the Lifetime Athletic Country Club of San Clemente. Yes, this is the final grand finale of Season 2 for Major League Pickleball. And the Chicago Slice just evened out the series to one game apiece on the win of Jesse Irvin and Lacey Schneeman. Gorgeous place to play pickleball. I tell you what, best stop on the tour. As we check in now with Hannah Johns, who is with Jesse Irvin and Lacey Schneeman now.
Some touches.
Well, a clean close out to take us to 1-1. Jesse, it really looked like you were targeting left side throughout this match. What was the thought there?
Yeah, we had played them previously in the last event, and, you know, we played against that team, and that had worked. So that was something I was going to stick with. And if we needed to change, we would make adjustments accordingly. But, yeah, I think when it comes to that backhand dinking, I'm really comfortable with it, and I can stay in that all day if I need to. So I felt like that was a good strategy going in, and, yeah, it worked out really well.
Guys, we're coming off of a big weekend where you played two events. Yeah. You played three events in the PPA event, and now you have to come out and do MLP Monday and hopefully Tuesday. How's the body feeling, and how do you strategize for such a long week?
Yeah, it's definitely been it's been a long year. So this is capping it off with two events back-to-back is a little bit tough, not going to lie. It's been a long weekend, but, you know, lots of stretching, trying to stay mentally fit, just trying to stay focused and push through this last little stretch, and then we can actually take it easy for a few weeks.
All right, guys, good luck. We're at 1-1.
Thank you.
Michelle?
Great stuff, Hannah, and really interesting to learn about that strategy, as you pointed out, Adam, to the left side of the court where Hurricane Tyra Black was playing. Jesse Irvin, the ultimate strategist, saying that she took some notes from their last meetings and got some adjustments, and it certainly worked. So now we move on to mixed doubles. We are tied at one game apiece. Jesse Irvin and Ben Johns taking on Tyson McGuffin and Mary Brosh. I had a chance to talk with Tyson McGuffin about this mixed doubles partnership. I'll give you the scoop after the break. Michelle McMahon, Adam Stone here with you on the call. As promised, Tyson McGuffin told me before this that playing mixed doubles with Mary Brasha, he described her as a right side demon. Adam says she doesn't give away too much. She's very consistent, and that's what he likes about playing with the steady partnership with the women on the right side.
Comfort.
Right side demon.
It's comfort. Comfort and a demon comfort. Yeah, whatever.
Cushy with a demon on the right side.
Yeah, and I think that it's very, very similar between Mary Brasha and Jesse Irvin. Ben's going to do his thing, so my pick to click is Tyson McGuffin. Can he be a beast out there and be a demon on the left side?
Jesse Irvin with the Ernie. It's interesting to me that Miami would choose to go with this matchup on Ben Johns. They must feel that Hurricane Tyra Black and Enrico Staxrud is a better matchup in the second matchup. Big play from Tyson McGuffin.
Yeah, that's what he's going to need to do. Impose his will with that forehand. Really put Jesse Ervin in some awkward spots.
Side out. Point three.
Nice low pull from Jesse Ervin. She kept it just low enough because Mary Brasha very ready with the two-hander. Just couldn't clear the net. Yeah, so it's you never really know because these matchups are so interesting because it doesn't just matter what your exact level is. I'll elaborate further. A lot of players get there in a different way. So it could be one player struggles heads up from this player, but they dominate this other player who could technically be higher ranked than them. So all of these games within the game, who's in front of you, who's cross-court from you, it's all for a reason, Michelle.
Point.
Ben Johns goes right down the middle on Miami.
5-2.
Nice shot from Jesse a couple times now. I do think Mary was in the right spot for both of them. Couldn't come up with either counter, though. Nice offense from Jesse from the right side. Interesting sound bite there from Jesse Ervin.
Sounded like a bird.
Uh-huh. And she went with the one-handed, one-handed backhand counter, too. Nice little backhand poke from Tyson. Just jamming Jesse up enough where she couldn't keep it in the court. I'm not sure if that was a drive or a drop from Mary, somewhere in between, but left high. Tyson digs one, can't dig two.
7-3.
Just long on the third shot drive from Johns. Quick conversation between Brasha and McGuffin, and here we go.
Side out, point.
Full throttle, Ben Johns from the kitchen.
Yeah, nice loose arm put away. And just a couple of the thirds and fifths and beyond. High for Miami early.
Touch from Jesse Ervin inside out of the air.
Yeah, that was nasty. It really was. Great deception from her. She had pulled those previous two forehands right to the middle of the court, and this time she manipulates the wrist nicely to go inside out back behind Tyson.
Side out, point five.
That's twice now Tyson able to jam up Jesse in the midcourt. He's going to need more of the same. Tyson more ready for that middle shot, but Brasher's drop sitting up enough for Jesse to fully release on that.
Oh, Mary with the defensive play to the corner. Hometown crowd for her.
Yeah, I think everyone on the court and off the court thought that point was over. And Mary Brasha with the hands of gold. Nothing Ben can do.
Mission Viejo, California native right there. You can hear it with the crowd's resonance.
Point.
And a missed return makes this a three-point game.
7-10.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Jesse Irvin giving Tyson McGuffin fits right now on that line.
Yeah, Tyson looking to make a move, hoping Jesse Irvin was going to try to keep Mary Brasha back, but Jesse Irvin's balance of consistency and offense is really on point early.
An 11-7 lead for Chicago on the end change. Tyson McGuffin strategizing with Federico Staxrud trailing by four.
Combination, big drive from Irvin, catching Mary Brasha transitioning forward.
13-7. Point.
Jesse Irvin.
I know that Miami ended up winning that men's doubles match, but Ben's partners are playing very well so far, and I think that's the big difference. Jesse Irvin just on fire.
Yeah, drops are on point, and then Ben Johns can do things like that.
Yeah, that's right, and you know, you can see Tyson maybe trying to overextend a bit, but can you blame him given the situation? Got to find a way to put some pressure on, just hard to do it against this team.
McGuffin eventually puts it away. Jesse Irvin couldn't miss a reset ball. It was trapped at the baseline.
Yeah, that was a heck of a point. And yeah, you don't get to say, you know, 21st shot drop too often, but that's what we got out of Jesse Irvin right there.
Why couldn't she come up?
Side out, point 16.
Gonna be fun playing mixed doubles with Ben Johns.
Oh yeah, and he's
full freedom.
16,
I'll tell you right now, his legs look a little heavy to me, to be honest. To be honest with you.
Well, consider the circumstances.
That's true.
Play
that's
a round robin format in men's singles against.
And a short hop slice attack of some sort on that last one.
Side out.
That's one of the better 17. Drops from Mary and a good look on the forehand side from McGuffin, but just weathered by the slice nicely.
17-9.
That penetrating return from Tyson McGuffin took a full crack at that forehand, the ball getting on Ben very quickly.
10-17.
Tyson McGuffin goes straight ahead at Jesse Irvin. A little bit of a run here for Miami.
11-17.
Top spin drop shot. Don't hear that phrase too frequently either. And that was not a miss hit. That was on purpose, ladies and gentlemen.
Point.
Line for McGuffin. The slice within two. Mentioned Ben John's legs looking a little heavy. He told me he was still sore from men's singles that happened on Thursday. That rarely happens that he's sore after any of his events.
So still, Thursday was a long time ago, Michelle. So still lingering in there, huh? Yeah, and it's not, you know, I mean, they're up 2011 here, and it's not like he's playing poorly, but he's a little more standing straight up than using, you know, some of that knee bend that I've seen so much from him and tagging McGuffin on the right shoulder to finish this one, 21-11.
A 21-11 finish in favor of Chicago. Can Lacey Schneeman and Eric Lang be the two in charge to close it out for Ben John's team? We'll see what Miami has left with Hurricane Tyra Black and Federico Staxrud taking the stage. Both players struggling in their gender doubles matchups. We'll see if they can rally. It's all up to Lacey Schneeman and Eric Lang whether or not they can close this one out in four. But if not, we will go to a singles dream breaker. But for now, let's check in with Hannah Johns, who is with her brother Ben, and Jesse Irvin, and how they were able to dominate that mixed doubles game.
Well, Jesse Irvin clearly very happy with the victory out there. Interview started, sorry. But we love the dance party out here on center court. Obviously happy with the result. Talk about that last game.
Yeah, no, I think that was a pretty clean game. You know, I just kind of do what Ben tells me to do, and usually that works out for us. So, and I always like having like a game plan. I'm very good at following directions, and I play my best when I know where I'm supposed to hit it and things like that. So generally my game ends up being cleaner. So yeah, it made it really easy.
Ben, you build this team around doubles partnerships. You want to go 3-0 or 3-1 every match. This might come down to singles. What are you thinking and saying to your team?
Yeah, you know, it was definitely unfortunate that we didn't get the men's doubles. The plan obviously would have been to just 3-0 it right there. But yeah, I think we still got a good shot at mixed here. And of course, dream breakers are very volatile. So even if we're not a singles-based team, there's always a good shot at an upset. So I'm telling them to try to close it out here. And if not, we got another shot at it.
Love it. Let's see what happens. Michelle.
Great stuff, Hannah. Good question there with the Dream Breaker, which you had pointed out at the beginning of this match. It is very clear that Miami is more built for a Dream Breaker than Chicago. That is obvious with who they have on their roster. As Ben Johns put it positively, there's still always a chance. But if you're Miami, you want this to go five.
Yeah, that's what it's all about when you're playing the slice. You got to get it to a Dream Breaker. And, man, that is a lopsided affair right there, 75-25. So a pretty high percentage chance we will be going to that Dream Breaker. But Miami, I mean, we have the, I believe, second and third best men's singles players. And then you have two maybe top seven women. I mean, that's a crazy stacked singles lineup for them. But we got one more mix to play. Anything can happen out here, even if it is 75-25.
Yeah, you mentioned it. Federico Stackstrud and Tyson McGuffin both were here for the men's singles PPA finals, the first ever this past weekend. So they just extended the long weekend to hang out here with Major League Pickleball in the Season 2 playoffs. Hurricane's Tyra Black, she struggled a bit in their gender doubles matchup. How can she reset and regroup with a different mentality, obviously playing the right now in mix?
Yeah, so that's really what it was, is some of the soft stuff and the non-willingness to grind it out, and she's going to have to find a way to be that rock over on the right and play a bit of a more consistent game, because if those errors come early, the worst part about that is she does not get her big-time partner Stackstrud involved. And right off the bat, little flub of the footwork for Black and a mishit error out wide.
Fire fight won by Eric Lang, who was sturdy in that men's doubles matchup.
Yeah, you don't see those firefights where I think all four players got a paddle on the ball. The big man stepping over nicely, using that length to his advantage and finding a nice shot up the middle, and a quick 3-0 start for the slice.
3-0. Point one. 1-3.
Eric, two speed ups off the bounce. Decent look at the high forehand, but I like Eric being aggressive early. He's going to have to do it. Tough miss on the return from Schneeman. Kind of giving herself a brief talk.
3-3. Side out. Point.
And it's a very comfortable pattern for Federico. Forehand drive, backhand slice drop. Couldn't come up with that one, but I expect him to drive his forehand very frequently in this match. Hands from Lacey Schneeman after a great cross-court grind from the ladies. And a big factor for Hurricane Tyra, she is hitting A high majority of forehand dinks now, not backhand.
Lacey Schneeman spots the middle, threads the needle through it.
Yeah, I mean, it's two of the higher-end athletes we have on tour. The fact that she was able to push that up the middle with neither one touching it, very impressive.
Just wide off the pressure from Federico Stockstrud at the feet of Lang.
Yeah, that's the key. Always go with the feet of the big man.
Side out, point seven.
Nice job, Eric Lang, saying me, me, me. Letting Schneeman know that he would love to take that forehand over on her side.
7-4.
Some more nice offense from Eric Lang.
Heavy forehand of Federico Stocksrud.
Yeah, he's so good on the full stretch on the forehand side, whether it's in the back of the court in singles or at the kitchen line in doubles.
Side out, point eight.
Yeah, I don't think Tyra even really saw it land. Just kind of checking with the crew on their teammates and Johnny Goldberg on the sideline, but they are going to decide to not challenge.
Point.
Yeah, and that's, I mean, it's not a bad drive by Eric Lang, but just a kind of middling drive. And Hurricane Tyra, one of the better forehands from that right shoulder position. But the errors are coming in bunches for her. There you go. Nice job there. And you can see it's not a lot of backswing or follow through and plenty of power. She has got to have that shot in this match.
6-9.
Was there right on the back door down the line, and the gap is now starting to close for Chicago, only up by two.
7-9.
Black attacks Eric Lang straight ahead, makes it a one-point game.
And a little pep in her step, too. That's the first real kind of fist pump burst of energy we've seen from her. She needs more of it. Schneeman. So good on the side spin. Inside out from Schneeman. Very powerful, flexible wrist.
Point.
And you can see it with that last shot, and we are changing ends.
Chicago back on top by three. That's the run they needed to pull back ahead and on top of Miami. Looking to close this match out in four games. We'll see if they can do it.
This coverage of Major League Pickleball is brought to you in part by Toyota Prius. It's ace now. And by Circle, your water, your way.
Wow, what a view. Beautiful beaches here in Southern California. Just a couple of miles inland is the Lifetime Athletic Country Club of San Clemente. And Eric Lang and Lacey Schneeman got to 11 first. The comfortable three-point lead. We know how quickly that can evaporate, though, in Raleigh scoring.
There's the forehand from Hurricane Tyra, and I'm not sure we could see it, of course, during the commercial break, but she was kind of popping up on her toes, jumping around a little bit, getting herself going. I love to see her trying to find that energy. And boom, boom. Big forehand from Tyra, big forehand from Fed, and we have a one-point game. Nice job from Eric Lang. Loaded up on the forehand side. And also, you know, a bigger body. So that's a great dodge and a great matrix move to let that ball go out. I mean, it's big man, big target. I mean, yeah, he's nimble on his feet to get out of the way. It's not easy to do, especially when you have the heavy hands. Yeah, she knew it right when she hit it. She put her hand over her mouth like, oh my, don't do that.
It's third for Schneeman. Miami back within two.
11-13.
Yeah, nice drop from Fed. Almost kind of floating up there, baiting Eric Lang 12, into 13. Thinking he could be offensive with it. Puts it in the net.
Yeah. Lacey Schneeman steps in, 14. Embraces the firefight with Staxrud.
Yeah, great hands from her because, I mean, I certainly knew, and I think most people knew, that Fed was going to drive that next ball for sure. So the initial third shot drive, but he took 14, the fifth right 12. At Schneeman, and she weathered the storm nicely.
Point.
And just a couple feet off the kitchen line for Hurricane Tyra.
15, 12.
Not making clean contact with that first volley.
Lacey Schneeman pounces, gets a let cord, yes. But buries it.
That's right, incredible combination from her. 16, Federico 12. Stretched out wide on the backhand side on both of those forehands from Schneeman. Fist pump and a nice control of the kitchen for Miami.
13-16. Side out. Point.
So nice 17. When that ball sails just high enough that you can slap down on it and don't have to 13. Stroke through with topspin. Great decision from Eric Lang to just unleash the fury on that last shot.
Yes, point.
See Schneeman rolls it through the middle.
And what a great spot, too. She has gone back behind Federico the last three or four times that she has tried that shot. This time she leans in and goes right at the right hip of Fed. Just phenomenal spot picking from Lacey Schneeman.
You just mentioned a key distinction, I feel like, for a lot of amateur players out there between when to roll the volley and when to punch it down like Eric Lang just did. How do you distinguish the ball to do that?
Well, certainly the more court time, the better. You kind of get in those situations and you can figure it out. But I see a lot of players, even a handful of pro players, but especially at the lower levels, that really hit through that ball with topspin and it just doesn't have that electric pace on it when you whip through with a full overhead. So any time that ball is sitting up there high enough, unleash the fury when you got a shot. No reason to go with spin when you're in that position, just all pace and depth.
Eric Lang and Lacey Schneeman in good position, 3 points away from taking this match and advancing through to the play-in match for the finals. And if they do indeed finish this one off. Riley Newman, Christian Elshon, and the Kawamoto sisters await Ben Johns and company in the next matchup following this one.
You know they're hungry, too. They didn't play their best game in that previous match. And
yeah, what happened?
DC gets another crack at it, and I think that they are going to be very, very focused in this next matchup, whoever it may be.
Anything jump out to you about DC?
Well, I mean, I even mentioned it. It's like, I mean, everyone at home can relate to this. Some days you feel like you can't miss. Some days you feel like everything feels awkward. Everything feels uncomfortable. And, you know, it's not like they, you know, played absolutely terrible. They just didn't play their best game. So they know that. They're professionals. They're out here on tour all year long. So they know when they're playing clean and when they are not. And they all have such good mental games to refocus, put that match behind them, have a short memory, and get going for the next one.
See, Schneeman mentioned the fatigue settling in for a lot of these players. It's been a long year, longest for many of these pros. They've had to manage a lot of the schedule.
I love dance. I love dance. I love dance.